Hello, and welcome to Software Architecture Monday. My name is Mark Richards. I'm an independent consultant, hands-on software architect, and also the founder of developer2architect.com. And continuing with our integration styles, today in Lesson 21, we'll take a look at remote procedure invocation. Now, to review, as last week, in the book Enterprise Integration Patterns by Gregor Hope and Bobby Wolf, they identified four main patterns of integration: file transfer, shared database, remote procedure invocation, and messaging. In our journey on these integration styles, we've taken a look at file transfer. In the last lesson, we looked at shared database. In this lesson, let's take a look at the remote procedure invocation. So now, rather than just transferring data, we realize that we've got application A and B, and we're actually able to communicate, not only to transfer data, but also to invoke functionality, business rules, functions, to be able to return the result. And as a matter of fact, if we look at the protocols associated with remote procedure invocation, those ones that fit in here, of course, this is where REST would fit in, representational state transfer, as well as SOAP as well, Simple Object Access Protocol. We also have things like RMI that's used within EJB, and specifically RMI over IIOP, and also CORBA. I'm sure that probably sparks a little bit of familiarity with some of you. It does with me, because I remember CORBA back from the 90s, Common Object Request Broker Architecture. As a matter of fact, we have WebSockets, whether it be HIBE or HICSE, RFC, which is a request for comments, CGI, Common Gateway Interface. As a matter of fact, another one I would add to this list, especially recently, is gRPC, Google's Remote Procedure Call, which in fact sits on top of protocol buffers in HTTP2 persistent connection. That would also be a great example of remote procedure invocation. And as a matter of fact, so we've got this whole list of now being able to actually kind of connect to and communicate with another application. And as a matter of fact, if we look at the pluses here, isn't this an interesting journey? We saw kind of file transfer and then shared database. But now if we take a look at this, do you remember from the last lesson on shared database, some of the issues associated with shared database? It doesn't work well with ORMs. We've got performance bottleneck issues with the database. Certainly, we've got schema changes that we really can't make because we don't really own our own data. So we had data management issues. Well, isn't it interesting? If we look at the very first positive here of RPI, remote procedure invocation, this preserves the data encapsulation and ownership. And so, in other words, here, some of the deficiencies that existed in the prior integration style shared database now are taken care of with remote procedure invocation, because now I can go and ask for the data. This is very typical, for example, in a microservices ecosystem where we have to maintain the bounded context. And so now application A owns its own data. Application B owns its own data. I am free to change my schema and not impact anybody because I have a separate contract with application B to be able to give them that data or an aggregation of that data. And so the remote procedure invocation does in fact preserve this data encapsulation and ownership. As a matter of fact, with specifically web services, this is a great integration style for external systems integration. In other words, integration beyond a firewall. That's where its sweet spot really sits. And as a matter of fact, this is generally very easy because the frameworks are very mature. The tools are very mature. As a matter of fact, to start making RESTful calls, at least from a programming standpoint, it's a matter of adding a couple of annotations to our methods. That's how mature the frameworks have become. And so this looks like the best integration style so far, except it does carry with it some negatives. And the first one might surprise you, that in fact it does have a tight system decoupling. Now, this varies based on the type of protocol used within remote procedure invocation, but generally, if application A needs to invoke functionality on application B in a single logical unit of work per request, and if application B is not available, then I am tightly coupled with that application. I cannot complete my business request. There's no other way to be able to defer things. And so that's where we get that tight system coupling. As a matter of fact, depending on the protocol, application A, quite frankly, can't start unless it actually has a persistent connection to application B. And so that's where we start getting that tight system coupling. Granted, we don't need that with REST or SOAP, but we do with the other kinds of protocols. However, while we have good data encapsulation and ownership and be able to communicate across the firewall, specifically through HTTP, two of the problems that plague remote procedure invocation is that it falls short on a couple of communication modes, and that's async communications, which are very hard. You can simulate them, but they're not truly async because there's no true queuing mechanism associated. There's no guaranteed delivery concepts within RPI. And furthermore, it's really difficult to do broadcast capabilities. If I have something to tell everybody and I really don't care for a response, I just need to let everybody know I just deleted a customer out of my database, it's really difficult to do here because essentially I have to connect to each and every source to be able to tell them that. In the next lesson, the final one in integration styles, lesson 22, we'll be taking a look at messaging as an integration style. So this has been Software Architecture Monday. My name is Mark Richards, and please stay tuned next week for the final integration style lesson. Thank you very much.